Welcome, everyone. It is an honor to be here for the first time as your MC for Habitat's Beyond the Build Luncheon. I'm Aaron Wright, news anchor and reporter at Cairo 7, and I'm really proud to be here today to share in this mission. Part of what drew me here to Seattle was Cairo's commitment to the community, and at almost every stop in my career, I've had the pleasure of working with Habitat for Humanity. I've seen firsthand how this work can be life-saving and life-changing for people across the country. As we gather in person for the first time in 2 years to support Habitat for Humanity's mission, our theme is Building Hope for the American Dream. Throughout the program, you'll hear favorite tunes about the concept of home, some of which evoke hope, while others highlight the struggle that can be all too real in our region, with the median home price in King County reaching nearly $1 million last month. This dream has been put out of place for so many people, but there is hope for hardworking individuals, and that hope is Habitat. As you will hear today, in part due to the pandemic, but also because of the urgent need, Habitat has innovated with new models that have proven successful, and now they need your help to scale up. But first things first, to offer up a prayer of thanks and hope for all good things to come, please welcome Pastor John L. Voswig of Our Savior Lutheran Church in Issaquah.
We pray together. Lord God, I give you thanks for every individual in this room as each seek to respond to the challenge of homelessness in our communities. I give you thanks for Habitat for Humanity, Seattle, King County, Kittitas County, for the immensity of the work done and mercy extended. And on this day, I particularly am grateful for the young professionals, the young folks that we see in this room all about us, who now are also dedicating their lives to the cause of homelessness. Bless them and the inspiration that they provide. For now, you provide us yet again with the feast before us, for which we are grateful. In the name that is holy, we do pray. Amen.
And Pastor, thank you for those kind words that mean so much to everybody here in this room. I know we are all thankful to live in a community that cares so much about all of its members. Each one of you here today is evidence of that. You're here because you shared Habitat's conviction that every person deserves to have a safe, decent, and affordable place to live. Your gifts today will fund affordable home ownership. There's more than just pride that comes with owning your home. There are tangible and lasting benefits. According to research compiled by Habitat for Humanity International, 3 out of 4 Habitat partner families say their overall health improved after moving into their new home. We also know from research that children of homeowners do better in school. The graduation rate for children of homeowners is 19% higher than for renters, and they are twice as likely to go to college. There are enormous financial benefits to home ownership too. The average Habitat homeowner builds $80,000 in equity that provides wealth, stability, and peace of mind, in addition to a nest egg for future generations. And because Habitat homes remain in the organization's permanently affordable home inventory, a single Habitat home benefits family after family for decades. Your support for Habitat also keeps people in these homes already with repairs thanks to a repair program. For every home that Habitat builds, they repair 3 or 4 more, enabling seniors and low-income families to remain in the homes and neighborhoods they've loved for many years. At a time when the lack of affordable housing has reached crisis levels in Seattle and King County, your support for Habitat has never been more critical, and we thank you. All right, we've got some special guests to recognize today. First, Habitat's platinum sponsors, the socially conscious, community-focused businesses who donate $50,000 or more each year to support Habitat's mission. Thanks to their generosity, every dollar you donate in our program will go directly toward building strength, stability, and self-reliance through affordable home ownership. All right, please hold your applause because we're going to name all these people and make sure they all get thanked here today. All right, alphabetical order, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Blueprint Capital, Harnish Foundation, John C. and Carol K. Hughes Foundation, Lenore Hanauer Foundation, Microsoft, Packer. Second use, Shepherd of the Hills Lutheran Church Weyerhaeuser Alumni Build. We thank you. And many other businesses support Habitat year-round, and for this luncheon, be sure to read their names on your screen and in your programs. And when you're deciding where you do business, please consider these community-minded ones that support causes you care about. So let's give all our corporate partners and businesses who contribute to Habitat's mission another round of applause. Speaking of generous businesses and benefactors, later when you have the opportunity to make a gift to support Habitat, you'll actually be able to double the difference by responding to a $100,000 challenge match. Thanks to a $100,000 gift from an anonymous donor, every gift you make of $250 or more will be matched up to that $100,000 total. A very special thank you to that donor. And a bit more well-deserved recognition, Habitat's dedicated board of directors and its hardworking staff make sure your donations are used efficiently and effectively to build and repair affordable homes. And our table captains who invited each of you here today have ensured we will have a full house of generous people to support Habitat partner families. Quite a few of our Habitat partner families have joined us this afternoon as very special guests of honor. And our elected officials who have joined us today, with all our elected officials, board members, staff members, table captains, Habitat partner families, stand and be recognized. Habitat for Humanity is one of the most engaging charitable organizations in the world when it comes to involving volunteers, including the dedicated AmeriCorps volunteers who serve with Habitat for a full year at a time. If you are now or have ever been an AmeriCorps Habitat volunteer, would you please stand? Last but certainly not least, we'd like to recognize Habitat's Volunteer of the Year, someone who has dedicated countless hours to Habitat as board member, board president, and member of the Resource Development Committee, and who led one of the most successful fundraising campaigns in this Habitat affiliate's history, the remarkable Steve Hill. After a 32-year career at Weyerhaeuser, Steve turned his attention to civic activism, using his amazing tenacity to benefit countless organizations, including Habitat, with the Weyerhaeuser Alumni Campaign. Steve led a group of 8 retired Weyerhaeuser executives to sponsor a campaign that resulted in pledges from 94 of their former colleagues. Together, they committed nearly $1.2 million to Habitat over 5 years. While he could not be here today, please join me in thanking Steve for his incredible service with a round of applause. Now, please welcome Habitat CEO of Seattle and King County, Brett D'Antonio.
Thanks, Aaron, and hello, everybody. I can't thank you enough for joining us back at the Convention Center for the first time since 2019, believe it or not. And through the challenges of COVID-19 and hosting our past 2 luncheons virtually, we've managed to accomplish a lot over the last 2 years, and it's because of supporters like you. So I'm thrilled that you're here with us today, and for us to give you an update on what we have going on. As Aaron already mentioned, our theme for this year's luncheon is Building Hope for the American Dream, a dream that is eluding so many as it relates to the anchor of this concept, home ownership. Since we last gathered in person, the housing market in King County alone has skyrocketed. It's leaving families behind. The dream of an affordable home is further and further out of reach. Now, current estimates show that we need 244,000 additional housing units in King County by 2040 to meet demand and to maintain affordability. And as an organization that believes everyone deserves a decent, safe, and affordable place to live, we've had to get creative. In reference to that, I'd like to highlight a few Habitat builds. First is Copper Pines, a surplus lot donated by the City of Seattle and Seattle City Light as part of the Housing Now initiative. It brought homeownership to 7 families in Ballard just last month. In December, Governor Jay Inslee visited the site to champion for increased density to address the area's missing middle housing, since affordable homeownership is a key to solving our housing issues. In South Park, what once housed one single-family home on a double lot is now home to 13 two-bedroom cottages. Blueprint Capital, one of our supporters, assisted Habitat in buying the land for its land trust and creating the award-winning design for these cottages. Habitat's meaningful partnerships with community-led organizations like South Park's Duwamish Valley Affordable Housing Coalition ensure that these homeownership benefits remain equitable and community-driven. Looking at two other models of Habitat's innovation, in Capitol Hill, we are building up for the first time with a 13-unit condo of 1, 2, and 3-bedroom units at 11th Avenue East. Completion is planned for early 2023. These condos allowed us to more than quadruple the total number of units in an area where housing is needed direly. And I'm happy to report that another community in Capitol Hill is in progress and will break ground in the coming months. We also broke ground in September for a 7-home North Bend community, Tylertown, and that was thanks to a generous private donation of the land. We're able to maximize the current zoning and create these permanently affordable homes in an area where affordability is rare. These are just a few examples of the many recent builds we have or are in progress, and we're maximizing every opportunity through smart partnerships, private and public. Now, solving the affordable housing crisis in our region takes a coordinated effort of nonprofit, public, and private sectors. We were thrilled when Habitat for Humanity International, along with 83 of our U.S. affiliates, including here in Seattle, received news of a transformational donation from philanthropist Mackenzie Scott. We intend to pair these funds with existing donations to advance our critical efforts in land acquisition and development, home building, home repairs, and homeownership education. In fact, I'm excited to announce for the first time publicly to you all that we are already leveraging the capital provided by Ms. Scott's gift. While we were all here this morning, we also closed on a property on Martin Luther King Way in Seattle. The property, located on light rail, It is a 4-minute walk to the Columbia City Station. This transit-oriented development will be home to 58 permanently affordable condos, and when it's complete, it will be the largest single building built by Habitat for Humanity in the world. While we are incredibly grateful for Ms. Scott's generous gift, it's only a fraction of the budget needed to address the affordable housing challenges that lie before us. To put it into perspective, our current construction budget is $111 million and consists of 270 homes in the pipeline. King County overall is one of the most expensive housing markets in the nation, with reported construction costs being some of the highest in the world. We need to address the risk of housing insecurity for low-income residents and people of color in the area. While affordable housing offers opportunities for those in our communities to enter into or preserve existing homeownership stock, the process comes at a market rate cost. There's a huge gap between the cost and affordability. Your generosity is just the beginning in the fight to create and preserve affordable housing. It is with your partnership we hope to continue leveraging funds from private donations, modest government sources, so that we will light the way and bring hope to those in need. With that pipeline of 270 plus homes, we're on track to far surpass the goal set at our last in-person luncheon in 2019 of serving 1,000 cumulative housing solutions by 2025. Looking ahead, we're thrilled to share our future community in the vibrant Capitol Hill area, Olympic Ridge. This 17 condo unit community features 1 and 2 bedroom homes slated for fall 2023 completion. another great example of meeting families where they work, live, and attend school. Also this summer in Kittitas County, we begin vertical construction on Stuart Meadows in Ellensburg. These one-story permanently affordable homes will provide 18 families each a three-bedroom, two-bath. It was made possible by 3 acres of land from the city of Ellensburg. And as for right here, the Seattle Housing Levy is a lifeline for supporting affordable housing and advancing racial equity. With this 2016 levy set to expire at the end of next year, please consider it a critical component to the work we do as it comes up for renewal by ballot. So thank you again for joining us and for your generosity. While we celebrate our affiliate's 36th year working to build self-reliance for people in King and Kittitas counties. And as you'll hear later today, there is much work to be done. So thanks to people like you, the incredible community members who believe in Habitat and donate your time, talent, and treasure, we know we can change even more lives, and we're grateful for our support. I'd next like to introduce to the stage Habitat Board President Kat Sims.
Good afternoon, everyone. Great to see all of your beautiful, smiling faces here today. I wish that I could sit with all of you on some of our wonderful furniture. By the way, this stage has been furnished by a Habitat store. So if you haven't been into a Habitat store lately, please drop in and see one. It is my pleasure to introduce Bank of America. Bank of America's partnership with Habitat for Humanity, Seattle, King County, has spanned well over 25 years and represents philanthropy at its most meaningful. Through the engagement of their employees, as well as financial contributions, Bank of America has been a champion of Habitat's vision that everyone have a decent and affordable place to live. As a long-standing partner, Bank of America sets the gold standard for what it means to be a corporate partner to Habitat. Since 1995, in King County alone, Bank of America has committed more than $750,000 to Habitat. That's right. In addition, Bank of America employees have contributed more than 155 volunteer shifts across 19 different group volunteer days. These amazing Bank of America volunteers return year after year, and they have been instrumental on our build sites, repair sites, and in Habitat stores. Please would all of our Bank of America volunteers stand and be recognized. We appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you. In addition to supporting Habitat Seattle King County, Bank of America has a long-standing partnership with Habitat for Humanity International. Launched from the early years of Habitat's Jimmy and Rosalind Carter work project, the partnership has continued to grow, totaling more than $75 million of committed support to Habitat's work around the world, with more than $55 million of that in the form of cash and property donations for Habitat Humanity International. We are humbled and we are grateful. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Carrie Schroeder, Seattle President of Bank of America, to accept the Community Leader of the Year Award, which we present to Bank of America with our deepest gratitude.
I say, come home, come home. I've been waiting for you so long. so long. Right now there's a war between the vanities, but all I see is you.
Thank you so much, Kat. Let me start by saying how wonderful it is to be gathered here today with all of you and to receive this recognition. I'm Carrie Schroeder, and I have the privilege of serving as the president of Bank of America for Seattle. As Bank of America continues to pursue our commitment to grow responsibly across King County and in all of the communities that we serve, we deeply appreciate the nonprofit partners that are building pathways to economic mobility and stability. Habitat for Humanity of Seattle King County has been one of those steadfast partners for decades. So we're honored by this award as we continue to work together to find solutions that expand safe and stable housing here in King County and beyond. At Bank of America, we understand that individuals and families who have access to an affordable home are better positioned to achieve their long-term goals, including better outcomes at work and educational opportunities for children. But it's not a surprise to anyone in this room that the housing affordability is one of the most persistent economic challenges that our region faces. In fact, I read recently in the newly minted Axios Seattle newsletter a Redfin report that said Seattle residents have to earn 34% more than they did just a year ago to afford a median-priced home because of the rising real estate prices and rising interest rates making mortgages more expensive. Last spring, you needed to make $113,000 to buy a home here in Seattle. This year, you'd need a $38,000 raise to achieve that same goal. And as inflation undermines budgets of many families and individuals, they're having to dig deep and get creative to manage their finances. But Habitat has always risen to the challenges of the time. And when people have a decent place to call home, our whole community can thrive, which is why we've had this long-standing partnership with Habitat King County. Together, we've helped increase access to affordable home ownership. We've donated existing homes, helped seniors and veterans stay in their homes through maintenance programs, and worked to deliver financial education to new and soon-to-be homeowners. So I want to take a moment to recognize my teammates that have joined us today, many of whom have volunteered with Habitat, have provided financial support, or both. Thank you all for your dedication and your service. And on behalf of my 2,000 teammates here in Seattle, thank you for recognizing the power in working together to build a more thriving community. We're so pleased to be your partner and humbled by this recognition. Thank you.
One more time for Bank of America. Your leadership and inspiration to us all, showing how we can all give more and be a little bit better. Now, let's get to the heart of the matter today, what we're really here all to talk about. Habitat's impact, hear about it directly from someone whose life has been transformed by Habitat for Humanity. Please welcome a new Habitat homeowner, Nicole Evans. Nicole.
Hi everyone, my name is Nicole Evans and I'm a Grateful Habitat homeowner. I'm gonna move this down a little bit. I'm so excited to share my family story with you today. It's been about a year since we were one of seven families chosen to be part of the Copper Pines community in Ballard, and we're moving in August and we're so excited. My husband Levi and I, we grew up in Spokane and we were high school sweethearts. From the time we were teenagers with part-time jobs at fast food restaurants, we've been saving for a home one day. Owning a home and having stability for our family has always been important to us, and it's been a top priority, especially for my husband, Levi. Levi was born and raised on a small piece of tribal land in Rocky Boy, Montana, and is a proud member of the Chippewa Cree tribe. He has worked hard to instill his native pride and teach our kids all about his culture and everything that he was taught. We also try and instill love and the importance of community in our children's lives constantly. Levi has volunteered for the Run of Hope through his job several times. Last year, when the pandemic forced most of the schools to close, he built an outdoor structure for our son's preschool so that they could continue to learn outside in the Seattle rain. It was pretty funny, a bunch of preschoolers out there. During Christmas, for the last few years, we worked with our community. Seattle is an awesome buy nothing, and so we would get a lot of toys donated for a few families that we know that financially struggle, especially during the holidays. But our seven-year-old daughter has impressed us, honestly, with most with her love and desire to always help the unhoused population. When she learned a few years ago that not everyone gets birthday and Christmas presents, she was absolutely heartbroken. She ended up taking her own money and putting together gift bags to hand out whenever the opportunity presented itself, and she still does this. Each gift bag is sparkly and includes a lot of essentials, but always must include at least a piece of candy. She said the perfect gift always has candy in it, and I have to agree. We are so grateful to be giving our children a happy and a safe childhood, and being able to qualify for a Habitat home really solidified us feeling stable. Unfortunately, my husband Levi's childhood was far from stable. He spent many of his early years unhoused. When he was 8 years old, his mom had to leave Montana with him and his three other siblings one night with only a few bags and the clothes on their back to get out of a bad domestic situation. Living on the small piece of tribal land was the only thing that they'd ever known, but his mom was determined to make a better life for them. They arrived in Spokane and they couch surfed as a family for several years until his mom was able to save enough money to rent a home for them. Levi definitely knows what it's like to be unsure of where he's sleeping at night and his next meal and of what the future in general holds. He's really stood out from his family to get where he is today. He's worked incredibly hard to graduate high school, get his AA degree, and work full-time and many overtime hours to save for our future. When my husband and I moved to Seattle, we moved about 9 years ago, we knew this was the place we wanted to start a family and raise children. We wanted water, mountains, nature, city, and a place our family could feel at home. A few years ago, when we had our first child and we had just gotten priced out of our apartment, we decided that now was as good a time as any to start looking for a home. So, you know, it was on Zillow and we had what we, looking at everything, we had what we felt was a nice savings, very high credit scores, realistic expectations, you know, stable jobs. And when we crunched the numbers, we thought that we could move outside of Seattle city limits and, you know, find a tiny one or two bedroom condo and that would be okay. Unfortunately, our dreams were crushed almost immediately by a realtor who let us in on a pretty well-known secret in this area, and unfortunately a lot of other areas, we would be expected to outbid people. We were already barely at the line of being able to afford the cheapest home we could find, but now we were expected to have another $50,000 to $75,000 just to outbid. We wondered how we would ever be in a position to buy something if this was the case. We felt defeated. I had heard about Habitat from a childhood friend whose family was actually able to purchase a home through them, so I signed up for email alerts. We continued saving for our future home, and after another 5 years and our second child being born, I was so excited to see they were finally building in Seattle. We immediately applied and were completely thrilled when selected. We had told the kids that if we were ever able to buy a home, they could have a pet and also eat ice cream for breakfast. And so this was that day. yeah, very exciting. Yeah, they still try to get ice cream for breakfast, but no. We are proud to not only say that we've completed over 250 volunteer hours, but I had no idea in the process of the friends we would make along the way. We did a lot of building out in Renton this year alongside the AmeriCorps volunteers, and it's been an incredible experience. I never thought that I would see the day where I was operating a table saw with ease. Here we are. I'm so thankful for all their help and patience. If you've never gotten a chance to work on a habitat build, please consider it. This past year has been a whirlwind. The whole process has many ups and downs. The wait has been hard. And as with all homes under construction and during a pandemic, it's taking a bit longer than it's expected. We do a lot of home buyer education courses via Zoom, and sometimes it has felt overwhelming with all the information. However, the Habitat team really has been so encouraging, guiding us through the process. They are always quick to return our many emails and phone calls, and they've never made us feel like a question we've asked is dumb or silly. They've really felt like an extra team of support this last year, which is awesome. There's our picture. We have finally started packing, and I'm finally, getting to throw things away too that I've wanted to for a while. Levi and I have never been able to even consider talking about what color we're going to paint the rooms or what we get to plant outside because of always being renters. So this is really exciting. It's been so fun to dream about that lately. My kids seem to be the most excited to have their own rooms that they get to decorate, and also they finally get a pet. So they're really excited about that. This has never been a possibility in any of our other rented homes. Levi's mom also reached out and told him how proud she is and how far he's come. So I know a lot of people can be the first one to graduate high school or college in their families, and Levi is the first person to own his own home. Which is really cool. Habitat has really changed so many families' lives, and we're thrilled to be part of that statistic. To the donors who have made not only our dream, but countless other dreams possible and a reality, thank you. Owning a home was unattainable to us until we connected with Habitat. And now that you've helped to make our dream of homeownership come true, our kids will have a stable home in the heart of the city that we love, near their friends and their school. We will never be stressed out about having to move again because, rent's going up or the landlord sold the house from under us. Because of your generosity, we can finally feel settled. And a home is truly the best gift that you can give. So thank you. And now I want you, please meet a few other people who can tell you how Habitat has changed their lives. Thanks.
Debbie Waters. I moved here from Detroit and have been here since 1977. My house was built in 1929, and so as it aged, things would start falling apart or breaking down or whatever. The concern I was having was the safety coming up and down these stairs. They would wobble and they were steep. I am 74 years old, retired on a fixed income. Now, when I was working, then I could do different things to make repairs. But on a fixed income, I don't have the money. So a friend of mine told me that Habitat was doing some projects in her neighborhood, and she gave me the website. So I filled out the application, and by the end of the day, I had a call. Habitat came to my home. They built new steps in the front. They replaced a rotted portion of my wheelchair ramp, a broken gate, a gutter on the back of the house that was clogged. They put in the flooring in my living room, dining room, kitchen, and hallway. They did so much more around here to improve the safety of my home. I was not aware at first that the volunteers were from AmeriCorps. Once I found out, I understood why they were so good, because I've had experiences with AmeriCorps before, and they are just wonderful people. These in particular, by the time they left, it was almost like an extended family. When they finished, they actually gave me a thank you card. I can't believe it. Someone drew a picture of the front of my home. Inside said, thank you. Now, mind you, they worked on my home. And I was so shocked, and I'm almost crying now, because just to think that they were actually thanking me for working on my home. That was very, very moving. And they were just the sweetest, sweetest people. And I will cherish this forever. Habitat for Humanity is a blessing.
My name is Demon Tsai. I have been volunteering with Habitat for Humanity since 2017. In the beginning, it was about once a month, and eventually that started ramping up over time. So now I try to go out at least twice a month, if not every weekend. I have volunteered over 800 hours, and I think somebody didn't get the math quite right, because it definitely did not feel that long. When it comes to volunteering with Habitat, I really love that aspect about giving a hand up. I did not get to where I am today by myself. I have a lot of people giving me a hand up along the way. Habitat Young Professional is a group that aims to provide an avenue for people in this area that would like to volunteer for Habitat to donate their time towards affordable housing. And it's an environment where everybody's welcome, but we have fun doing it at the same time. You get to meet a lot of awesome people. You get to learn new skills. Working with Habitat is important work, especially nowadays where homelessness has become so unaffordable, and it really shouldn't be that way. We really shouldn't be pricing people out of their houses. Definitely is very important work just to be able to get back.
I'm Asha Dore, and I'm a Habitat homeowner. I live in the High Point community with my three children. Margot's 10 years old, Liesl's 12 years old, and Francis is 7. And we moved in June of 2020. Being financially responsible for three kids is pretty tough. I've always wanted to be able to provide them with stability and just a consistent place to live so that they could stay in the same school and have an idea of home instead of moving from place to place based on rent prices. Being in the Seattle area was important because I really wanted to center Margot's medical care in Seattle Children's, and with having all the doctors in one place. Margot was born with a condition called arthrogryposis. She has multiple joint contractures, so some of her joints were stuck bent. We found out later that she has a genetic condition that they have named ZARD. Basically, it just means that she has trouble, you know, moving her body the way that typical kids do.
Stretch your shoulders up if you can.
It takes her a longer time to learn to walk and learn to do things that are easier for us. When we moved in here, you know, we didn't used to live in a place that had stairs, so the stairs are actually a really amazing physical therapy tool for her. Habitat installed an extra railing so that she can use both as she's walking, but it means that we don't have to go to a physical therapy clinic. We can just have therapy in our home. The rising rent costs are really what prompted me to start looking at Habitat. I really wanted to own a home and just have more autonomy and power in the space where I live, and it just feels like I'm able to actually take care of my kids in my own place. But in the Seattle area, it's totally impossible with a single income. So I signed up for their email list, and then this home, when it popped up, it seemed unlikely to me, but I applied and it happened to work out. There's enough space for all of us to have our own space. I don't have anxiety that I'm gonna get a letter saying that I have to leave because they're gonna sell the house, or that rent is gonna go up $400 or $500 a month. I'm in control. My mortgage is gonna stay the same for a really long time. I feel like I have stability. That's the most important thing that I could ask for. To the donors, thank you. It's truly changed so many people's lives.
Without contributions from everyone like you, it wouldn't be possible to have so many projects going up at the same time. Every dollar counts.
There are so many things that I could not have had the energy or the strength or the know-how to do that they did for me. And were it not for your donations, they would not be here to do these things for me. And for that, I'm grateful.
All right. Are those stories inspiring or what? I mean, this is why you do this, right? This is why you give. This is why you help everybody. If we can get somebody medical attention, we got it. And aren't we all lucky to be in a room with so many smart, talented, and caring people? Again, a reminder of just how great everybody here is. And it's not just about giving, it's about living what Habitat is all about. And again, it's clear from these powerful stories that the lives of local families are forever changed by the support of Habitat for Humanity. Thank you, Nicole, for sharing your powerful story. Debbie, Asha, for allowing us into your lives so we can see the firsthand impact that you've made, and also a big thank you to Habitat board member and president of the Seattle chapter of Habitat Young Professionals, Damon Tsai. A big thank you to all you guys for sharing your stories today. If there's any young folks out there, HYP is a great way to get involved with Habitat, and now it's time for your keynote speaker. Hailed by the New Yorker, as an acute and compassionate observer, Nomadland author and journalist Jessica Bruder reports on social injustice, subcultures, and the dark underbelly of American capitalism. In a feat of immersive journalism, Bruder drove from coast to coast and from Canada to Mexico, a total of 15,000 miles, spent months living in a secondhand camper to better understand her subjects' lives and experiences. She came away determined to shine a light on the urgency of providing affordable housing, raising the minimum wage, preserving Social Security, and decriminalizing homelessness. With our nation's economic future seemingly more unequal and more unstable every year, Nomadland presents a look at how the American dream has failed some of our most vulnerable citizens. A New York Times notable book and an editor's choice selection, Nomadland won the Discover Award and was a finalist for the J. Anthony Lucas Prize and the Helen Bernstein Award. The book was turned into an Oscar-winning film starring Frances McDormand in 2020. Please give a big, warm Seattle welcome to Jessica Bruder.
Well, I never had a place that I could call my very own. That's all right, my love, because you're my home.
Getting close to the point where I need reading glasses, and I've realized I can make text huge when it's on my laptop. So this is not an ad for Apple, forgive me. So first of all, I want to thank Aaron for that wonderful introduction, which I will try to live up to, and also for his work bringing communities together through journalistic storytelling, something that means a lot to me. I'd like to thank Brett D'Antonio and Amy Ferrier and the board of Habitat for Humanity for inviting me here to help celebrate your 35th anniversary. It is a joy to help celebrate your successes and your ongoing commitment to a mission that becomes more urgent every day, helping people achieve safe, decent, and affordable housing, and once they get it, helping them stay there. We know homelessness has increased by 40% in Washington in the past 5 years, so that mission is more important than ever. Everyone deserves a sanctuary, a stable, familiar place where at the end of the day, they can relax, close the door, and if only for a little while, let the outside world disappear. Home is one word, but we all know how many meanings it has. Home is about dignity. It's about physical and mental health. Home ownership is the most common way families build generational wealth. That impact echoes far ahead into futures we can't even imagine. And none of it works if housing isn't affordable. If housing is affordable, no one has to make the impossible decisions. I call this the impossible calculus of whether they're going to make the rent or pay for medical care, food, utilities, clothes that keep them warm. But you know all of that. I want to tell you why your mission means so much to me. Okay, so show of hands, this is the audience participation part. Don't worry, I will not ask you to dance. And I won't be offended if you've either read the book Nomadland or seen the movie. Okay, we've got a few. Oh, cool, all right. All right, I'm gonna talk to the audience. So let me just tell you a little bit about it for those who haven't. Nomadland was a 3-year project. To write it, I spent months living in a camper van. I named the van Halen because I like bad jokes. Sorry. So Halen was my home while I was documenting itinerant Americans who gave up traditional housing and hit the road full time because this enabled them from travel to job and carve out a place for themselves in an increasingly precarious economy. I went from the beet fields of North Dakota to the National Forest campgrounds of California to Amazon's Camper Force program in Texas. And what I saw was how employers had discovered this new low-cost labor pool made up of largely transient older Americans. These are people for whom Social Security came up short, who were underwater on their mortgages, who were trapped between the growing gap between wages and the cost of shelter. Many of them were invisible casualties of the Great Recession. They had taken to the road by the tens of thousands in late model RVs, vans, few sedans, few tents, and trailers. I met all sorts of people out there, from a former professor to a former McDonald's vice president, a minister, and a motorcycle cop. So many people who'd worked hard all their lives and yet found themselves in this losing game. One of the people I met was named Linda May. She became the main character of the book. Linda had done everything. She'd been a Home Depot clerk. She had defeathered quails at a hunting lodge. She'd been a general contractor. She had been a cocktail waitress at the Riverside Casino. I got to see pictures of her outfit. It was amazing. So the first time I met Linda, we talked for hours, and she told me something that really freaked me out. She told me how at Thanksgiving a few years earlier, she'd considered taking her own life. And she thought about doing that because she just couldn't imagine a situation in where she could retire and have shelter at the same time. She just couldn't imagine it. She said, I'm gonna turn on the propane and light a cigarette and blow us all to hell. Well, I'm really glad she didn't do that because she's become like family to me. And what she did instead was she hit the road in this old beat-up RV, and that's how our paths intersected. So Nomadland came out way back in 2017. It's hard to imagine now given all the things that have happened in the past 5 years. But today, vehicular homelessness, people who are using vehicles as shelters of last resort, that is the fastest growing subgroup of homelessness. This is also a population that is increasingly criminalized. We've got ordinances all over the country that are making their lives harder and harder. Some places forbid overnight parking. Others disallow inhabiting a vehicle outright. These penalties, they pile up very fast and unpaid. They can lead to the cruelest punishment of all, which is towing. If you don't pay an impound fee, you lose not just a car, but a home. So many people I met lived in fear of what they call the knock. If you've seen the movie, you may remember The Knock. There's a scene that was really poignant to me and also brought back a lot of anxious flashbacks. The character played by Frances McDormand, who is named Fern, she is just settling down in her van to have dinner. She's in a parking lot, it's all quiet, and suddenly we hear, I don't know if that came through, but kind of, all right. And you know, I don't know why it is always three knocks. It is like the dot, dot, dot is like an ellipse, and it means it's time to move on. She jumps up, she swears, and we know that that peaceful dinner has been ruined, and that's it. She's got to move on. This face hovers at the window, and you hear this gruff voice that's like,
No overnight parking. You can't sleep here.
People I met on the road knew that phenomenon incredibly well. One of them was a woman named Swanky. She's 76 now. She told me she had nightmares about the knock when she was sleeping in her 2006 Chevy Express van. I have this strange, surreal dream of someone knocking, she explained. Usually it happens if I'm not 100% comfortable where I'm parking. A van dweller I met named Bob Wells had this whole super popular online video called Avoiding the Knock, and he lectures on the topic for other van dwellers. He was at this gathering called the Rubber Tramp Rendezvous out in the Sonoran Desert, and I sat there and listened while he shared tactics about what I learned is called stealth parking. The idea is maybe you can create a police-friendly alibi. Maybe you can make your van look like a contractor's work vehicle. Maybe you can blend in. These were sophisticated strategies to hide. When I first heard Bob talk, I thought, wow, these strategies, they are so clever, they are so creative, they are so resourceful. But of course it sunk in. The second conclusion was that in a better world, nobody would have to go to such lengths to stay out of sight. Weirdly, I knew the knock too. I mean, I was a glorified tourist out there, right? But spending the first night in my 95 GMC camper, I could not sleep. I was awake for hours and hours, and every time a car went by, the window shades would light up, first white from the headlights, then red from the taillights, and I was entirely freaked out. Is that car slowing down? Can they see I'm in there? When they'll call the cops? Even months later, when I kind of got used to it, I was parked outside Linda May's family home. It's a very temporary home. And I remember the house next door, there was somebody like trimming the bushes or something, and I kept thinking, I am trapped in the van. I can't come out of the van while he's trimming the bushes or I'll be in trouble. And I found myself just crouching and hiding in the van until he was done and went away. I mean, it really, even if you're out there a little bit, some of this gets into your head. So for me, when I think about this, I think about how having a stable home means that people don't have to live that way. They don't have to feel hypervigilant. They don't have to feel hunted. Home lets them build community with roots, with social cohesion. And that's why I get so excited when I see photos of the people that Habitat helps, when I hear stories like Nicole's. I see the opposite of the stuff I reported on for so long. I see people like Marga Newcomb in front of her house in Burien, who got her sewer pipes fixed and the bonus of stairs and then even the grass replaced and now can age in place. I see Debbie Waters, who's that retired senior who has a home in Seattle's Beacon Hill neighborhood where she was living, along with her grandsons and her son, and a mixed German shepherd, gotta have the dog, Oliver. Good that I know the dog's name, but not the kids. We can talk about that later. I have a dog, I don't have kids. All you need to know, I love kids, it's okay. Anyhow, when I see Debbie Waters and I see this picture of her standing in front of her freshly built stairs, and I think about her refurbished floors, and I think about what that means, not just to her, but her family, it gives me the chills. It's the story like that that gives me hope, even knowing how big the problem is that we face. So what I'd like to do is wrap up by actually telling you a story that I haven't told anybody apart from like my friends and other journalists and stuff. So what I want to tell you is the real ending of Nomadland. Nobody knows this. Every week I get questions by email saying, did Linda May build her Earthship? Now, Linda had a dream of building this kind of 1970s sustainable architecture thing that's amazing. It has discarded tires and like glass doors, and it is a very big undertaking. So every week people ask me that. The other thing people ask me the most is, what was the best thing about the whole experience of, you know, standing there and meeting people in the desert and then telling a story that puts them on a magazine cover and then in a book, and then suddenly they're co-starring with Frances McDormand? It's like, it's very confusing, I can tell you that. But the best thing about it really overlaps with what happened to Linda May. So again, Linda May, when I met her, she was contemplating just ending it. Just yesterday, Linda turned 72. Linda has a house. Linda bought a house. I'm not gonna tell you where because she's out of the public eye. But Linda bought a house exactly 1 year and 2 days ago. I remember the texts lighting up my phone when she bought it. Just yesterday, it was so cool, I could send her flowers for her birthday because I knew where she was gonna be. And it turned out the florist was just down the street, And the florist knew her address because other people were sending her flowers too. And again, it blew my mind. It was just the most exciting thing to see. Linda suddenly had a neighbor she adored. Linda loves animals. There were cats in the neighborhood, so Linda feeds them. I have a picture on my phone of two really cute kittens curled up on a cushion next to a pillow that says Home Sweet Home. Linda named it the Sunshine Manor because her mother used to sing You Are My Sunshine to her, and she used to sing that to her children. So when I think about the power of a home and how that echoes through generations, and I think about Linda at the Sunshine Manor, my heart just soars, and it soars in the same way it does when I look at the work you do. The most exciting part so far, well, first Linda moved in. She gave me a FaceTime tour. She'd saved money on the home by agreeing to clear it out. Previous owners were hoarders. She showed me, I said, you're gonna find something really weird or really cool. I wanna see it. She showed me a medieval spiked battle club replica that she found in the attic. That was really interesting. And all sorts of stuff. But for Linda, when I met her, she was in an RV and then in a 12-foot fiberglass trailer. And I thought I knew her. I'd been following her for 3 years. I knew she was very kind and very loving and very generous. What I didn't know is that a huge part of her personality is hospitality. I didn't know that because she was living in a 12-foot trailer. So suddenly, Linda has space to be the matriarch of her family and have that family gather. And last Thanksgiving, a Facebook posting went up that made me cry. It was Linda's neighbor. And Linda's neighbor was installing holiday lights on the roof of her house when she looked down. And what she saw on the sidewalk was Linda. And Linda was there with her daughter, Audra, and her son-in-law, Colin, and the grandkids, Gabby, Christian, Jordan. Julian was there with his guitar, and they were singing. And they were singing carols. And I've got to tell you, I'm an atheist, but Oh Holy Night has now brought me to tears. So I want to thank you for the work that you do. And I want us all to be able to hold those moments because there's so much more to do, and I am so glad you are doing it. Thank you.
My name is Janet Otieno, and I'm a Habitat homeowner. I am a single mom. My daughter is 19 months old right now, and I am a CNA. I am originally from Kenya. I came here because my mom and my brothers were here. So I was living with my mom. She lives in Renton, and in 2020, I got pregnant. And once I got my baby, I moved out and got a one-bedroom apartment. Where I was living was unsafe. We had a few incidences of people pulling the gun on the staff members, and there was a time there was a shooting incident just around the apartment complex. Once I got accepted to the South Park project, I started working with lenders, and I started also working towards my sweat equity. For this community, I had to put in 250 hours by the end of the first year. And for me to get into this home, I had to do 50 hours. It's been beautiful giving back to the Habitat community because I have received so much. Whatever I have received from them is amazing, and it's beautiful to know that I also have a hand in making someone else smile. So my house is a two-bedroomed house. There's a good, sizable living space. I have my own washing machine and dryer. That are my biggest achievements in life, I feel. I love it. It's been a blessing. And my child is thriving here. She's so happy. Habitat for Humanity, for me, was a godsend. They met me at my lowest, and they gave me hope for tomorrow. Hello once again. My name is Janet Otieno, as you heard, and I'm a proud Habitat homeowner. You learned a bit more about my Habitat journey in the video, and my story is just one of many people who benefited from this amazing organization. Now, here's the opportunity to make a big impact on permanently affordable housing. We only have one event each year, and you are really counting on your support. Please consider to make a bigger gift here today than what you might have intended when you walked in. 100% of your donation is tax deductible. Oftentimes, it is very surreal to sit in my safe, beautiful home with my daughter. I wonder where I would be without Habitat. I would still be renting in apartment buildings that did not feel safe. Thanks to all of you, a young girl from a village on the shores of Lake Victoria, somewhere in East Africa, now owns a whole home in one of the largest cities in Washington State, Seattle. Above all, my daughter is really thriving in our new home. We now have a safe, stable place to live. My dreams of home ownership only became a reality thanks to positive response from people like you, As your table captains hand out the envelopes, please remember that every donation of $250 or more will be matched thanks to our generous anonymous donor. That means that every gift of $250 becomes $500. $500 becomes $1,000, and on, up to a total of $100,000. So please consider doubling your impact. You can also text to give today by texting the word BTB 2022 to 71777. Again, that's BTB 2022 to 71777. So easy. You can also click on the QR code to go to the event page on our website to donate. Or if you prefer to mail a check, please send it to the address on your screen. I am here to attest that your donations are not in vain. They change lives. You've changed the lives of my daughter and I. And in the same stance, I now use this opportunity to stand in the gap for families who might not even know it yet that you're about to change their lives. Please help us make this dream a reality for other hardworking individuals in the community. Thank you.
All right, Janet, thank you so much for sharing your story. Truly an inspiration to all of us. And as you continue to fill out those contribution forms and think about what you're giving and the change that you're making in someone's life, hopefully we are all inspired by Janet and today's Habitat families to add a zero or two, little more, give till it hurts today. Give a little more than you initially thought. I want to remind you that every dollar you donate here today goes directly to support Habitat homeowners. That's because Habitat's generous corporate partners have covered all of the costs of today's event. This makes your investment today go even further. And as Janet and I have mentioned, remember that every gift you make of $250 or more will be matched up to a total of $100,000. How often do we get the chance to double an investment the moment we make it? It's not often. And while we're talking about good deals, allow me to draw your attention to the lovely furniture set featured here on the stage behind me. It's beautiful stuff. It's going to look great in your home. Yes, yes. You might not know that the Habitat Humanity SKC operates three discount home improvement stores in King County. When you decide to redecorate, you can donate your gently used furniture to a Habitat store. If you're a builder or a contractor or a plumber and you've got a surplus of lumber, tiles, sinks, or large kitchen appliances, you can donate them too. And of course, you can shop for those great bargains at a local Habitat store with every dollar supporting Habitat for Humanity. Check out the locations and sign up for alerts about sales and great new items at www.habitatskc.org. Take a picture of it back there because that's what I do because I always forget these things. Now I want to get to ask Jeremy Williams, Senior Vice President, Seattle Market Executive with Bank of America, to join me on stage We got some raffle tickets for you here today. So before we put you out the door, something really exciting, because I know what the prize is, and I've entered several times to try and win this. It's two tickets to the Seahawks game against the Denver Broncos, Monday, September 12th. I think there's particular interest why this game's so important to people. So get your pull. This is on you. So whoever, this is going to be on you. Whatever happens. All right, everybody's got their ticket. 254718. 254718. We got a winner. Excellent. You're taking me and Jeremy with you. It's going to be great. I look forward to it. Jeremy, thank you. All right, all right. And, of course, go Hawks, and the quarterback the Broncos have, we wish him the best, just not on Monday night. As we conclude our program, we want to emphasize the biggest stars of today, each and every one of you, and thank you for being here to support Habitat for Humanity. Please keep the momentum going. Tell others why you have chosen to support this extraordinary organization. Donate or shop at the Habitat store. Get involved and volunteer on a Habitat build site. It's doing good in your community for one another. Remember, you're investing in your community when you engage with Habitat. Please enjoy this closing video made by the kids of Habitat. Again, thank you everyone for being here, for giving, and for doing what you do. Have a great rest of your day.
My name is Elijah and I'm five.
My name is Nadia.
Hi, my name is Walid and I like to play soccer. And my favorite place in our house is the backyard.
Hi, my name is Arushad Fazil and I'm in fifth grade. I'm 11 years old.
Hello, my name is Tommy. I'm 14. I'm in the ninth grade. What I love about my new house is that this house is clean. It gives us a fresh start, and now we can have full ownership over this house.
This house has helped our family with rent, and we have much more space than we actually had in our usual apartment, and we feel free in this house. It's pretty big for us.
Before, when I lived in an apartment, I couldn't have all of this stuff.
We have a lot of space to play in our backyard.
What I love about this new room is it's way bigger, gives us space for two beds. Before, I used to do my Zoom meetings on my bed with my cameras off, but now I have a chair and a desk where I can put my laptop and I can turn my cameras on and participate in class.
Thank you for my Habitat home.
Thank you for my Habitat house.
Thank you for my house, Nadia.
I'd like to thank all the donors for helping us own this home. I really appreciate what you guys have done for us and for this family.